welcome to the August 20th, 1991 Planning Board meeting for the town of Cape Elizabeth. This evening, the first order of business is the minutes of the previous meeting from July 16th, 1991. Any comments, discussion, questions, corrections? I didn't sit as chair on the discussion of the Highlands, and it seems to be fairly complex. I hope some of the members read through that to make sure that that's, this is the public record and that that's accurate. Any comments? If not, do I hear a motion? Mr. Emery?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the minutes be accepted as written.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the minutes as written, please raise your right hand. Opposed? It's unanimous. We ask the Planning Board workshop minutes be accepted by consensus. Is there any discussion, any changes, any corrections? I gather that means consensus, and we'll accept those minutes as written as well. Next order of business is correspondence for the past month. In the packet, we received the, I believe, amended sign ordinance. I believe that was acted upon by the town council during the last month. Does everybody take note and should be added to your sign ordinance manual? The second item being building information having to do with permits. It's a 13-year history, approximately. And I'm not sure who provides this. Is this from our assessor's office?
That was prepared by the town manager.
Okay. Very good. Interesting information. Permits are not necessarily the best guide for change in building, but certainly is interesting information to be added. Glad to see that, and I take it, Maureen, did you add this article from the Sunday Telegram?
Yes, I did.
Okay. It's a good article. Just for those of us who are novices at some of this, it's understandable. At least I thought I understood it. One that I didn't necessarily understand everything was the nuisance bloom and nutrients, nuisance loading, phytoplankton. I learned what flushing was. It's an interesting article if you haven't already.
The one on the zoning written by the fellow in South Portland.
That was in the workshop packet.
We all remember that. Also that I received, and I hope the other planning board members also received, a copy of the bill, an act to promote affordable housing for persons of low and moderate income. Its introduction, describes that the bill removes common law defenses that could impede the use of covenants intended to enhance the affordability of housing. It was an issue that was brought up when we were discussing and formulating our own ordinance on affordable housing. Take a look through this act. I would suggest you keep it with the ordinance, our affordable housing ordinance. There are some interesting parts to it. I read through it the last day or two. I was not aware that, I thought it odd that it talks about classes of persons, and I didn't realize that was in the law, that the state recognizes different classes of persons. Interesting article.
I'll make sure that any of the members of the board get a copy of that.
Did you see it came in this, enacted on June 18th? Okay. And lastly, a letter from myself, and I'll give you a copy of this, to Mike McGovern, our town manager, appointing Tom Emery to serve on the Town Planning Committee. Letter states that Tom will bring the depth of experience and planning vision to the committee that the Planning Board desires of its representative, and we'll be very pleased to have Tom represent us. First order of business under new business, Stonegate Phase 4, request by Robert Taylor, Stonegate Associates, to extend the time period for preliminary subdivision plan review of the 17-lot subdivision located in the area of Stonegate Road, Section 16-2-4A8. As I have in the past, I've recused myself from participating in this article as I'm of a conflict of interest, and I'll appoint Judith Kane to the chair. I might suggest, Judith, for this, you might appoint at least one other voting member.
I'd like to appoint Judy Lardner as a voting member in this, please. You've received a letter from Bob Taylor requesting an extension. Is there any discussion on this? Hearing none, do I have a motion? Judy? Ms. Lardner?
Oppose the following motion. Be it ordered that, based on the request submitted by the applicant, the applications for preliminary subdivision plan review, a wetlands alteration permit under the pre-May 90 provisions, and a permit for construction in a resource protection district under the pre-May 90 provisions for Stonegate Phase 4, a 17-lot major subdivision proposed by Stonegate Associates Incorporated and located off of Stonegate Road, be tabled to the November 1991 meeting with a mutual agreement of both the applicant and the Planning Board.
Is there any further discussion? Second?
Second.
All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. Opposed? None. It's passed 4-0.
Thank you, Judith. Next order of business, and we're right on time, shoreland zoning amendments to the zoning ordinance of expanding the shoreland zone and revisions to the wetlands regulations. Public hearing, section 19-4-9. Before we start the public hearing, I'd like to have our town planner, Maria Mira, a very quick outline synopsis of the amendment as it stands.
The reason the Planning Board is working on shoreline zoning amendments is because the state has adopted new guidelines, and it's now requiring all towns in the state to comply with those guidelines by the end of this year. The vast majority of amendments that are proposed are just to comply with the new updated standards. A small amount of the amendments proposed really are technical changes to the zoning ordinance and to the wetlands regulations. There really aren't any policy changes. Most of them are just clarifications of the ordinance and cleaning up some things that got missed the first time around. In terms of the shoreland zoning amendments that are being required by the state, the shoreland zoning amendments are doing a couple of things. One is they're expanding the area that the current shoreland zoning covers. It's 250 feet from the normal high water mark of any water. It also includes wetlands now, and it also includes streams, and that's 75 feet back from the normal high water line of a stream. It's also requiring that areas that are not densely developed and are located in floodplain zones adjacent to rivers or to non-tidal areas also now have to be zoned resource protection. Most of the change in the shoreland zoning are much more specific performance standards. Where previously we would have had standards that required that there be erosion and sedimentation control, for example. Now there are very specific ways that erosion and sedimentation control must occur. So in a sense, although it's a large bulky document, it's much more specific and should be a lot easier to enforce those general standards of not impacting the shoreland area. For the board, the memo in front of you reflects some of the most recent changes. If you'd like, I also spoke with the town attorney today, and he went through the amendments, and he just had a few revisions that he would suggest. I don't know if you want me to start that now or hold it off for later.
I think probably, for the sake of the public hearing, perhaps you might mention what those are, being that they're from our town council, town legal counsel. And before we discuss the different items, we'll open up to the public hearing after you mention those, and then we can go back and discuss through the different items.
Okay. Starting on page 3 of the amendments, at the top of the page, under number 2, authority, he is suggesting that at the end of that first sentence, instead of reading Title 38, Sections 435 through 449, that it states Sections 435 at sec, AT space SEQ, period, and then take out the 449. The next change is on page 12. Under F, parking areas, there's a typo, or that's actually an omission under number 3. A typical parking space should be 9 feet wide by, and it should say 18 instead of 20. On page 13, under number 4, the last line in number 4 states subsection P. It's an incorrect reference. It should be subsection N. On page 24, at the bottom of the page, the last paragraph, the third line, the second line of the last paragraph, it should state effective date of this zone, each may be sold as a separate lot. And those are all the revisions that are being, well, there is one more. On page 28, number 1 criteria, under I, it should say state wetlands rated instead of wetlands rates. The final revision he's requesting is that on page 29, and it also applies to page 30, underneath the double I, it states that the code enforcement officer shall be given written notice at least 5 working days prior to the start of any timber harvesting activities. In order to make it easier to cite this particular requirement, he's suggesting that it be moved into the paragraph above so that it would be included as part of that whole description that that starts at the beginning of the page, prior to timber harvesting in a resource protection critical wetland zone.
So not into the double I, but up to the
correct.
The full paragraph?
Yes. We would probably use it as the first sentence in that paragraph. It would probably be inserted prior to the word prior. And the exact thing would have to be done on the next page, page 30. The same statement is would have to be begin immediately under C, timber harvesting and resource protection 2, wetland protection zone. The one other note I would like to make is, as part of the amendments, the town also has to adopt a new zoning map which shows a shoreline zone. That is not going to be available for tonight's meeting.
Okay. Thank you, Maureen. It is, as you can tell from the description, a fairly sizable document. It's 34 pages long. At this point in time, I would like to open the public hearing on the shoreline zoning ordinance. I see a limited number of people here. Just remind members of the public that for a public hearing, we ask that you come to the podium and introduce yourself and limit your remarks to the issue under discussion, that being the shoreline zoning ordinance. I'd like at this point to open the public hearing. Are there any members of the public who would like to address the planning board? Seeing and hearing none, I will close the public hearing. I had hoped that we would have some public discussion. This is a sizable, physically it's a sizable document. It's an important document. I guess at this time we will proceed with any discussion from board members as to the draft of the document to be forwarded or proposed to be forwarded to the town council. Any discussion, questions? Perhaps I might have Maureen start us through some of those. Or are there specific questions from the board first, I guess? I actually only picked up on one myself. I get that out of the way. And I think I'll ask Tom Emery if I'm putting this in the correct place. But I believe on page 13, number 4, we talked about that choke, that slope being changed. I thought we talked about changing it from 2-to-1 to 3-to-1.
It's at the workshop, that's correct.
Okay.
That change was in the mineral extraction section, and that's been put in. I can add it to this section as well.
Do you think that would make it more consistent? Tom?
I don't see a problem with a 2-to-1 slope if the erosion control measures are applied properly.
Okay.
I mean, there may be instances where you have bedrock or other things that you hit in constructing a road that would make 2-to-1 slope acceptable.
Okay. I think we'll leave that one as it is then. Other questions? Judy?
First, I'd like to apologize for not attending the workshop. Some of these issues that I might want to raise might have been discussed, and I also have to apologize that ordinance development is my favorite planning topic, so I will have several comments.
Go to it.
I have some general questions that fall into the discussion section on Maureen's memo, and then lots of small comments page to page. So perhaps I could just raise a couple questions that Maureen addressed in her memo, and then let the other ones come in where it's appropriate. I think my major concern was under item 12 on her memo, page 2. She brings up two changes the state has made, allowing us to regulate a little less stringently than this draft is proposing. Was any of this discussed in the workshop?
No, it wasn't. These most recent changes at the state level were adopted in June, became effective in July, and I received some of them the day before this draft went out to you today.
Okay.
So none of this was discussed, and it is an appropriate thing to bring up.
Well, then as one board member, I would love to hear what other board members have to say about perhaps letting an increase in hours at least be considered not an expansion of a non-conforming use, but the second part of that paragraph with respect to requiring a merger of adjoining lots, I tend to be opposed to that. I think if a lot can be serviced by either septic system or can hook into the public sewer, there's no reason to require large lots. I'd like to hear what other board members have to say about that.
Judy? Yes, I do. Could you explain your thinking on that? I guess I'm not completely sure what
on the first part of that.
No,
or
the second part.
Because I tend to believe that the way we have been moving to larger lot sizes over the past however many years, probably since the 50s, is not an appropriate way of planning. Evan Rickert's opinion article said it a little bit. Also, in the most recent Planning Magazine, they have a large article on large lot zoning is really not the way to go if one does want to preserve natural features and such. Typically, I think you'll find these small lots already in somewhat densely developed areas, and it doesn't make sense to me to require, say, 2 8,000 square foot lots to be combined just because they happen not to be developed, as long as they can meet whatever septic requirements they must. You find that on, for instance, Munjoy Hill, a lot of small lots, but people can't build on the vacant ones now because of the zoning, or at least they couldn't a couple of years ago, and I think it's somewhat ludicrous because the neighborhood works, and why someone couldn't build a house that fits in with the neighborhood. But that's certainly a personal opinion.
Well, I think I agree with you, and I think as much, I just wanted to hear you say it.
Any other comment? You had a chance to look through that. Personally, I think I would concur with you, Judy, that, and Judith. I'm glad to see that less stringent position at least offered to the planning boards.
With respect to this first issue of whether one allows a non-conforming use to expand the hours of operation or add days of operation, I don't know if that would mean to the week or to the operating year. I'm not sure how I feel about it, and I didn't know if any other board members had any particular opinions.
With that, and I'll ask our planner, we recently dealt with child care ordinance and the applicant before, where we talked, actually in the ordinance, we talked about the hours and days. If is that where they, for instance, if they want to come in and be open on Saturday or Sunday, would that, what this is saying is that's not technically an expansion of use.
I guess you want to keep in mind that the shoreline zone is an overlay zone, so anything that happens, any particular use, has to meet the requirements of the underlying zone plus the shoreline zone. So, for example, if someone were to have a house that happened to be in a resource protection area, and immediately it becomes a non-conforming use. If they happen to use that house for daycare, and let's say they operated a portion of the week, or they operated all week and decide they want to operate on Saturdays as well, that's currently allowed in the underlying zone because of the new daycare amendments, but it wouldn't be allowed because they're also in the shoreline zone, and they're also a non-conforming use, so they wouldn't be able to expand their hours of operation because of that shoreline overlay, unless you were to not count an expanse in the number of hours of operation as an expansion of a non-conforming use.
Is a business like the Lobster Shack, is that non-conforming?
Yes.
So they could not open an hour earlier or shut an hour later, for instance?
Well, actually, it's non-conforming as to the underlying zone. I would have to look at it to see if it was non-conforming as to shoreline zoning. If it's set back a sufficient amount of feet away from the high water line, which I really don't have a sense of whether it is or not. I'm not sure how far those rocks go where the water doesn't have any effect any longer. They're probably not set back quite enough. In that case, if they were to want to expand their hours of operation beyond what they currently have, there could be a problem because they would be in the shoreline zone.
Personally, then, I might favor at least allowing an expansion of hours, possibly days. I don't know that I would favor much beyond that if it were a seasonal use to give them the privilege to go year-round, for instance. I'll think about it a little more tonight.
I think there's a lot of protection that's offered by the zoning of the underlying zone. And I think what Maureen just brought forward is I tend to keep thinking of this zone and forgetting that there is an underlying zone. This is an overlay, and I think that we have a lot of protections, and I personally think would be in favor of increased uses in this ordinance or in the zoning section.
Any other comment?
I'd like a clarification on the issue of the underlying zone. The one thing that the state hasn't provided us with that they've been trumpeting for the last 4 years is the inefficient use of land through typical single-lot subdivision. And I know there's been a lot of promotion at the state level for cluster development on waterfronts to preserve open space, but the shoreland zone that they've handed us is a very straightforward 40,000 square foot minimum lot, 200 feet of frontage. Developments within Cape Elizabeth utilize our cluster zoning provision, assuming it's within the underlying zone?
Yes, it can.
Even
in the shoreline zone, and there is a specific provision in here that states that you don't have to meet the minimum lot size requirement in a cluster development as long as the overall density does not exceed what would otherwise be allowed.
Okay. Any other comment? Other questions, Judy?
Two very minor issues that perhaps Maureen could look at. These are really picky. Throughout this document, there are the use of the word zone with a capital Z and a small case Z, if you would like to have one or the other. And also I've noticed, and this I'm sure is a function of how long the zoning ordinance has been developed, there are two sorts of hierarchical labeling, if you will, some of which start with capital A, go to numerals, then lowercase letters, and then the Roman numerals using small case letters. There are also the other way they do it is starting with small case letters to numerals to Roman numerals using small case letters and so forth. And if Maureen might over time figure out which is the best way, I think the first way is the standard way to do it now, and whenever we do ordinance amendments to try to keep it that way so eventually the ordinance will be consistent.
I guess that problem, it just continues as the new amendments come about. And we were discussing this just this afternoon. I think the only way you could really fix that would be to go through and redo the ordinance in terms of renumbering sections,
mm-hmm.
not changing wording, but just redoing it all. And if that's a priority of the board, that's something that certainly could be worked on.
For me, it wouldn't be a priority, but I'm sure you have a standard way you'd like to see it, and if at least this one could be that way. Is it the first choice? Is it usually capital A and then going to numerals?
It's supposed to start with a numeral one, a Roman numeral one, and then to capital A and numbers, and then you're supposed to alternate between numbers and letters.
Mm-hmm.
But different ordinances do it different ways, and this one seems to have mixed a couple of different procedures. I guess I just see it as, probably the newest part of the ordinance. A major part is the wetlands regulations, and you know that has the same kind of problems. And
okay.
So,
it was, as I said, a minor point.
Mm-hmm.
Could we go through this page by page like we did last time, just to remark on typos or what have you?
I think what I'd like to do, and I'll open it to the board for comment, is on the first 17 pages. Just take that as a group, if we will. In other words, not change to every page, but if you have comments on each page, the first 17 pages, we've gone page by page through that point. And then the last 17 pages, I have no problem. And I guess everybody should try to organize their comments as they go through, and so we catch them in that way. If we could take the first 17 pages, sure. The first, and I urge you to step in or throw something at me or something to get my attention if Judy goes by a point that you want to, or a page that you want to have a comment upon. Judy?
Okay, first thing I would recommend, on the first page under expansion of use, to rewrite that definition as the addition of weeks or months to a use's operating season, eliminate additional hours of operation, and then continue or the use of more floor area or ground area devoted to a particular use.
So strike the additional hours of operation?
That would be my recommendation.
On page one, under definitions, section 19.1.3. Okay. That's a good suggestion. The planners suggested as we go through these, as we're touching specific items in the ordinance, I'll ask for consensus or lack of consensus, and it will ease the voting, or at least the motion at the end, and so that the motion would be as amended by consensus. Do I get consensus, any discussion on removing additional hours of operation? Was that the only change?
Yes.
Okay, no comments, so I take that as consensus. Next.
Next thing I would recommend, and Maureen will probably want to think about this for a moment, down toward the bottom of page 2, section 19-2-7-02, Shoreland Performance Overlay Zone. My recommendation here would be to do a slight renumbering, to have that as instead section 19-2-9, which would have it following the wetland zones, which is also the way we describe the zones in the middle of the page under section 19-2-1. There's a certain ordering. And to accomplish that, what would happen would simply be that sections 19-2-9 through 19-2-11 would have their numbers changed. I think the ordinance would look a little bit better, and I always feel awkward about these dash 02s.
In the actual ordinance itself, where would that place the, what page? Place the shoreland performance overlay zone?
As I understand it, that would substitute in for the site plan review section?
It would be inserted right before that.
Okay.
Which is page 21 of our zoning ordinance.
Yeah.
And site plan would simply become dash 2-10, and then there are only two other items following that, very short sections.
The reason for doing this would be that right now every zone tends to have its own section. It starts with 19-2-3 is the R1 zone. 19-2-2 is the R1 zone, and then for every other 19-2-3 is the R2, the RC zone, and it continues in that way until you get up to the wetland zones. You have 2-6 is the business district C zone, 2-7 is Fort Williams Park, and then 2-8 is all the resource protection zones. So it still is relatively consistent. This is also a zone, so you would be giving it its own subsection. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then you'd be renumbering everything else.
Another comment? Anything?
Well, I'm just deferring to her expertise. If you give it a number, I can find it.
I wasn't quite sure, Maureen, what your preference is to leave it as it is with the current numbering?
In making ordinance revisions, my preference is usually to make as little changes as possible. Certainly, in terms of ordering and organization, it makes a lot more sense to have it this way. The only other concern I would have is I'm not sure when you'll be getting a new zoning ordinance. It may be, hopefully it would be immediately after this is adopted, since it's a major change. But typically an ordinance, you get a new one every year or so. So whatever amendments get made, you basically have to keep those extra pages and insert them in. But this is a large amendment, so if you were going to make a change like this, now would be the time.
May I add one other thing?
Gotcha.
What it would involve, actually, on the paper for us to make that change, would to add us. It would read section 19-2-9, cross out 10, underline, and simply say site plan review. Then we already have a revision to section 19-2 dash, currently 10, lots in two or more districts, so you can simply change that number to 11. And then we would have one more section simply to give the title of, which is called buffer areas. It wouldn't be that much more paperwork. Otherwise, what we have is Fort Williams zone is 19-2-7, I guess it would become 01. Shoreland performance overlay zone would follow right after it with all the wetlands. And since this is also an overlay zone, it could go over any other zone in here, and it makes more sense to be at the end. You've described all the zones, and here's this final zone that can be on top of any of the ones we've talked about. So I would urge board members to agree with that if you want to.
Make
sense?
Yes. Mm-hmm. One other question, are the cross-references in the ordinances that would have to be amended as well?
Yes, I didn't look and I
will. My approach is to do it right and not to have a bad ordinance, because it's easier to insert something unless at some point in the known future this whole thing's going to get rewritten, but I agree with Judy.
Okay. So make that correction now, mm-hmm. Regardless of the future.
Okay.
I take it that's a consensus?
I agree.
Okay, good.
May I ask, how was the ordinance prepared?
That's a pointy question.
For example, the city of Portland and South Portland hire a firm in Florida to provide updates.
The town manager's administrative assistant has responsibility for all the ordinances, and she and I are not on the same system, so all of this will have to be reinserted.
Okay. Next comment or question?
This is more a question for Maureen. It's on page 6, which is the chart talking about permitted uses in the wetland or the resource protection zones.
Before we skip to there, okay. I take it that we will take our legal counsel's on page 3, for instance, mm-hmm. We won't skip over that. We will include that as well. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's part of the consensus. To page 6?
Page 6. This is a question on, actually, I guess I probably have a couple more. Comment on 13, new road construction. It said in the floodplain zone, new road construction is not allowed. And I wondered if it might not be appropriate to also have that as a special permit, because often I would think the resource protection 2 wetland protection zones are going to be in 100-year floodplain zones, and we allow roads there. And I can't remember what the state, I think the state also allowed them in the floodplain with certain provisions having to do if they couldn't be located somewhere else. I'm not sure. Maureen will know better than I do.
It probably would be appropriate to indicate that as a special permit, because it is allowed by the state under special circumstances, and those special circumstances are in the ordinance, in the ordinance amendments as special performance standards. So that might be more appropriate if that's what the board would like. The reason it says no in the RP1 zone is that's what the original critical wetland zone prohibited. And I tried not to make any changes to uses that hadn't already been decided by the wetlands regulations that were adopted.
That makes sense.
Any other comment from board members? Whether to change to
new road construction.
Right.
Number 13.
Mm-hmm. Is that special permission?
Special permit under the RP3.
Mm-hmm. Is that acceptable? Okay.
Yes.
Going on then to page 7, this is a question for Maureen. Under number 35, home occupations, previous drafts had under the resource protection 3 zone, I can't remember if it said yes, it probably said special permit for home occupations, and I wondered why it switched back to no.
The reason I did that is under the guidelines, the state clearly says no to home occupations in any resource protection zone, and Since the RP3 has to comply with the minimum state guidelines, I had to switch it back to no.
Okay, thank you.
Maureen, through the chair, sorry. Will we be seeing this in the ordinance? Is it paginated in a similar, will it be paginated in a similar way, so this chart is on two pages?
This, when it finally gets into the ordinance, it'll look like the chart that you already have in your ordinance, with the heading above the chart and then the chart right below it.
And will the heading be carried forward to the second page?
I can request that they do that. I don't know if it's in there right now.
No, it's not.
No. We can see if we can do that.
I'll make that a consensus amendment, if possible.
Should I continue?
Yes.
Page 8, this would be the page where we would renumber the section I mentioned earlier. At the top of the page, it would read Section 19-2-9 with a strike over, and then numbers 10 underlined, Site Plan Review. Then the following section, that is lots in two or more districts, would be renumbered to 11. And following that paragraph, we would write in Section 19-2-11 with a strike over, number 12 underlined, Buffer Areas. And then, as part of that, as Tom suggested, I guess we'd have to have Maureen scan the ordinance and see if there are any references to those three sections that need to be renumbered.
Any discussion on those insertions and the cross-references? Okay. We'll include those.
The next comment could just be me. I had a very hard time at first under Section 19-3-6, the new Shoreland Performance Overlay Zone Regulations, figuring out what had changed. And Maureen, correct me if I'm wrong, is basically the entire section that was in there before deleted and then rewritten in some ways and put back in this order?
The way our ordinance is set up right now, all the zones have an initial description of what the zone is, and then there's another section that talks about what the specific standards are for the zone. Under our existing ordinance, the shoreline zone was left out of that second section. All the specific parts that talk about setbacks are in the performance standards section. So this is actually, it takes that, well, this is that performance standards section, but it's adding a lot of the things that just weren't there before that describe what the function of the zone was.
But what we see in our pages, in this, like say pages 8 through, I don't know how far it goes.
Are you talking about the actual performance standards by headings?
Yes, the whole section. I guess it actually runs through page 26.
It's actually, what I tried to do is, if you look at the shoreline zoning that's in your ordinance now, and it starts on page 31. And this section right here will be inserted for where page 31 is. If you look at those different headings, starts off with A, Agriculture, B, Beach Construction. Each one of these headings is still in this section. But what has happened as part of the whole state amendments is they've vastly expanded the performance standards for each section. So instead of having a rather simple statement that says you will not erode into shoreline areas, there is five or six different performance criteria where you have to mulch, your grading has to be to a minimum ratio, and that's why it's so much longer than it is right now. But each one of these headings is represented in the new ordinance you have in front of you, plus some new ones have been added. And what I've done is, whenever possible, I've kept the existing language and just added new language as necessary, as required by the guidelines. There were some places where I just had to eliminate the whole section. The only section I really had to eliminate was the section called setbacks, which, if you look into the state standards now, really is three or four sections.
So what we have right here is complete. There's nothing in here that we're retaining that has not already been rewritten into this.
Yes, correct. Any place that you look at between page 8 and 20, whatever, anything that's not underlined is whatever was saved of the four pages from page 31 to 34.
May I ask a question? I go to the chart, I look under RP1, critical wetland, and then I go down to multi-unit residential. It's not permitted.
Correct.
And then I go to 19.3-6 shoreline performing overlay zone regulations, minimum lot standards under multiplex housing. We're providing standards for use that's not permitted?
No, because the standards that you're looking at starting at 19.3-6 are the shoreline zone, which is 250 feet inland from any normal high water line, period. The standards you're looking at starting on page 6 and 7 are the allowed uses in resource protection zones. So the shoreline zoning that's required by the state actually is two different kinds of zoning that's being required. It's shoreline zoning of all those coastal areas and all those inland water bodies, plus it's resource protection zoning required of all sensitive environmental areas. So even though multi-unit residential is not allowed in a resource protection zone, it is still allowed in a shoreline zone. And that's what's being regulated starting in section 19.3-6. Does that make sense?
As it's explained to me, yes, it does. I'm not sure it's clear as I look at the ordinance that, well, if I understood the ordinance better, then it probably would be clear to me. But it's, the headings make it somewhat difficult to understand which one is being what the regulations are applying to.
It might be easier if someone were to come in to the building inspector's office with a particular project and ask, what can I do on this piece, this parcel of land, where you could look specifically at the zoning and you would say, okay, you're in the RA zone, plus you're in a shoreline overlay zone. So you would check the requirements for those two zones. And that way you'd never get to that chart, because that's a resource protection zone.
Okay.
It's a little bit more difficult since you're working with amendments all at the same time.
Any further questions?
I could keep going through page 17.
Mm-hmm.
I will make note of the comments of the town attorney in pages 12 and 13. I would certainly agree with those.
Thank you.
On page 14, at the end of the page, under item number 3, there's a reference to a section 19-2-8C, and I believe that's, it must have been made several revisions ago. I don't think that's a correct reference, and I can't suggest what is a correct reference.
Can you tell me where you are again?
Page 14, the last paragraph, which is a section 3 under H. It's the second to the last, first to the last sentence. It says, the planning board, in accordance with section 19-2-8, subsection C. And when I go back to that section, I think it's clear that that's not what it is. That's under now the wetland zones sections, but I don't know what it's referring to.
Actually, it's not there. Is simply have the planner appropriate the correct reference there, and then instead of all of us trying to find what, where, which number may be a typo or where, why the reference is incorrect, but except by consensus that we find the appropriate reference. Is that all right, Ron? Okay. Next.
Page 15, this is getting picky, and I know this is language from the state, but a lot of the ordinance language, I think they sent us, reads very awkwardly. Under J, Mineral Exploration and Extraction, Section 1, I wonder if it might not read better if they say, no part of any extraction operation, including drainage and runoff control features, shall be permitted within 100 feet of the normal high water line of Great Pond, nor within 75 feet of the normal high water line of any water body, and so on.
True. Surprised Janet didn't pick that one up. See, that's consensus.
And move the beginning of that down to the end of that paragraph. The unless,
pardon?
Move unless authorized through Section 48C, move it to the end of the paragraph.
I don't care. That's the kind of thing I don't mind if it's even fixed up more. I try to ignore a lot of it. It drives me up the wall, this language, but I try not to be too picky.
Okay.
On page 16, number 3, on the third line down, there's still reference to district that escaped you, Maureen. Probably one of the last. Should be zone. And a question further down, it talks about the plan shall be filed with the planning board. Later in the document, when we get to page 31, there's, I think it's a pretty much the same paragraph with minor changes. And there it says the plan shall be filed with the code enforcement officer.
I've lost where your references are.
I'm sorry. Still in Section 3,
mm-hmm.
they're talking about you have to have a soil and water conservation plan.
Mm-hmm.
And it says,
okay.
The third line down, the plan shall be filed with the planning board. And later,
Sixth
the same
and
sort of.
Line.
Yeah.
Okay.
The later in the document, the same sort of paragraph says it should be filed with a code enforcement officer. And
just why don't we skip to that right now so we can.
If you go to page 31.
Mm-hmm.
Under the agriculture section in paragraph 3, which is the final paragraph of
mm-hmm.
that page.
Okay.
You go down again.
Line 4 and 5?
Yes.
Is there a difference there, Maureen?
Actually, I think what may have one time had been sent to the planning board is now being done by the code enforcement officer. Most of the stuff under the shoreline zoning, because the performance standards are so specific, it's much more of an administrative task. And a lot of things, unless there are some problems or people can't comply with the standards, a plan would be sent to the code enforcement officer and he would approve something. So just because you're in the shoreline zone doesn't necessarily generate the need to go to the planning board. You have to have more than that. What I would recommend is changing on page 16 the word planning board to code enforcement officer.
Do we have a consensus there?
Yes.
For a change?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
And number 5 simply has in the first sentence another reference to district that should be zoned.
It's worse than a word game, you know. If you play it for a month and a half and you still can't get all those. What's wrong with this picture?
Final comment I can make now, because we're on page 17, is a typo under section. It's lowercase b in the middle of the page. If you go down
mm-hmm.
1, 2, 3, 4, fifth line, either be removed or be disposed of as instead of on.
Take that as consensus. Okay. Well, is it okay with the board to just continue through the same
mm-hmm.
same pace and rate?
Yep.
Or accelerated, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Other questions?
Well, keep going.
Yeah.
Page 18,
mm-hmm.
subsection or section F, there's another similar paragraph later on. This reads extremely poorly. Maureen is, and this is the state language, not Maureen's, is the purpose of this to say that skid trails, log yards, and other sites except for water crossings have to be treated as the paragraph describes? The way it reads is they're accepting all these things, and I think they mean only to accept the water crossings.
That would be my interpretation.
I would recommend it instead read then skid trails, log yards, and other sites, comma, excepting water crossings, comma, and then continue on. And then toward, let's go down by lines, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And on the sixth line down, there's a typo. It would read mineral soil and the normal high water line of a water body. And then I would make one more change in this paragraph. If you started then in the seventh line, for each 10% increase in slope, comma, the, and I would insert, width of the unscarified strip shall be increased by 20 feet.
Okay.
Perhaps so we don't waste time. If you go to page 30, section 7, it's the same paragraph again, and I would recommend the same changes. Except, the skid trails, comma, insert log yards, comma, and other sites.
And except for water crossings comes after other sites?
Yes.
And the change, I lost it already here. The width of?
Width of.
The width.
Of the unscarified strip.
Oh. Next.
On page 19, first section 1, Great Pond, the P on pond should be capitalized. Section 2, this is another one that I think reads extremely awkwardly, and I might suggest it read, I'll read it and then I'd like Maureen to comment. Except in areas as described in paragraph 1 above, and except to allow for the development of permitted uses, then I would delete, or for those portions of public recreational facilities adjacent to public swimming areas where cleared areas are limited to the minimum area necessary, then continue with that sentence within a strip, so on. But I don't know how you feel about that. That, what I just read, is pretty much what the state language reads now, and I'm not sure why this language is different from the state's.
I believe I am in an attempt to clarify. Or would you like to revise that back to the state language?
I think the question is, why are we describing that? And I can't remember whether that was an item of discussion or not, dealing with public recreational facilities.
Yeah, the problem is if they make this buffer strip requirement, you might not be able to put in those other things that you need in order to provide public access to the water. So you want to require a buffer strip, but you don't want to require it for public recreational facilities. But then they don't want to make you, someone may put a public recreational facility that doesn't have to have access to the water. That's why it gets very long and tedious.
If that were a topic of discussion at the workshop, I'm happy to let it stand since I wasn't there.
No, I'm not sure that it was.
No,
I was just asking. Any other comments from other board members?
I think I revised it because when you have to read four lines before you can figure out what the requirement is, I think it exhausts people. So I started out with a buffer strip shall be required, so it's kind of like a signal. A buffer strip shall be required, and then it goes on for three lines when you don't need it, but you still know it needs to be required, so you keep reading to figure out what it's supposed to be.
Okay.
That's kind of the theory.
I'll buy that.
How about semicolons? Would that make it?
I just think whether it's a, I don't.
I think it's just that the introduction is short, and then the further explanation takes three lines, but I don't think it's incorrect.
I think it's going to be awkward either way, so I'm happy to let it stand as written right now.
So we have no change there. Next.
On page 20, section 5, second line, shall be regulated as opposed to regulation. Simply a typo. And further down on that page, under Section 1, it talks about a plan, again, this is an erosion sedimentation control, shall be submitted to the permitting authority, and whether that's the planning board or the code enforcement officer, or whether it changes, I don't know, but it should be specified if we can.
I've been working on this. There was one section where I deliberately left permitting authority because it could change. And frankly, I don't remember if this is a particular section or not.
There is another section, it might have been, Maureen, on page 22 under archaeological sites. Mm-hmm. Permitting authority is supposed to determine if something is supposed to be on the Natural Register of Historic Places.
I know that's not the spot. This is the place where I put this in. The reason I did it is because anytime you have any development in the shoreline zone, an erosion and sedimentation control plan is required. If someone were to come in with a residential development or any other project which required planning board approval, I would assume that the erosion and sedimentation control plan would have to be submitted to the planning board, because it would be part of the whole review of whatever the project would be. Otherwise, if someone were to be building a single-family home, which would require approval of the code enforcement officer, then the erosion and sedimentation control plan would be submitted to that official. And that's why I left that that way.
That makes sense.
I guess, in general, if that phrase shows up, that Maureen, you take a look, and if it is a specific and only one specific authority, then that be mentioned. If it could be multiple, then leave it just as it is. Next.
I guess this is a question. I'm all the way to page 24 now. Question to Maureen. Under Section 1 of the nonconforming uses, if we have revised the definition of an expansion of use, this language can stay the same in this section, correct?
This is correct.
Okay. Then I would go on to page 25, which starts off with contiguous lots, vacant or partially built.
I just mentioned we did, I believe that was a legal counsel's addition on 24.
Correct.
Include.
Yes.
I'm sorry, go ahead, Judy.
Page 25, this is the paragraph dealing with forced merger of lots if they are not built upon. And I would recommend it read as follows. Most of it is as written. If two or more contiguous lots or parcels are in single or joint ownership of record at the time of or since adoption of or amendment of the zone, if any of these lots do not individually meet the dimensional requirement of the zone or subsequent amendments, and if one or more of the lots are vacant or contain no principal structure, I would add the following. The nonconforming lots may be conveyed separately or together, provided that the state minimum lot size law, state subsurface wastewater disposal rules, and the town sewage ordinance are complied with. That language is borrowed from an earlier section.
Could you reference that section?
It is borrowed from page 24 under contiguous built lots.
That's another tough paragraph to begin with. But it was important at that time. That was an item of discussion to make sure that those regulations were mentioned. Any other comment?
Gotcha. There's a small typo in mine, too. Or in joint ownership of record at the time or since adoption of amendment. Is that right?
Where are we, Judith?
On the second line of contiguous lots.
Of record at the time of
or since adoption of.
I just could read it either way.
Or should it be, is it adoption or amendment?
Time of, or, since adoption or amendment of this zone.
Why don't you just say time of amendment of this zone, since we're amending it?
True. Strike.
Of adoption of.
Or since adoption, rather.
Or since adoption of. So we'll read, at the time of amendment of this zone.
Should there be an and before the if on the third line?
Give me a clue where on the third line you're looking.
Same place.
I would say no, because there is one clause following that on the fourth line, which does start with and.
There are three if statements.
There are three? I don't know. See, I want to put them and if. Or is it or if?
No, it's...
So they have to meet all three
criteria?
You
have to meet all three criteria.
I guess I think it would be more clear to me if it had another and in there, but I'm not going to.
I don't particularly care as long as
no,
it reads.
I'm just.
We leave that to the planner's discretion. How's that for being?
Oh, that's. I agree with that.
Next.
Further down. Section 4.
Is there agreement, consensus on that amendment?
I'm sorry, the insertion of that phrase, page 24.
Right. What you would be doing is you would no longer be requiring non-conforming contiguous lots to merge, as long as they can meet subsurface disposal mm-hmm. regulations.
And this is what we originally referred to back in number 12 of the discussion item. Is that all?
I do have a question.
Mm-hmm.
What if there are two contiguous lots under either single or joint ownership, which when combined don't meet any of the criteria?
Then they wouldn't be able to separate them anyway because they
No, but
can't.
Could they be conveyed jointly?
With this amendment, they wouldn't be able to be conveyed jointly either. We could just state that the non-conforming lots may be conveyed separately as long as, and take out the or together part. Because what if I've got it down correctly, starting with the third if one or more of the lots are vacant and contain no principal structure, the non-conforming lots may be conveyed separately as long as those three bodies of subsurface disposal are met with. So if we wrote it that way, you still could convey the lot jointly.
And why wouldn't we want the or together in there?
Because if you said or to, you would say that they still may be conveyed separately or jointly as long as they met these rules. If they don't meet the rules together, then they can't be conveyed at all.
They couldn't be conveyed?
They can be conveyed, but they can't be built on.
Right.
Just so you know, I took that language also from contiguous built lots with
right.
respect
mm-hmm.
to separately or together, and I mm-hmm. thought that it preserved to the owner of such adjoining lots that I could then divide them and sell them to you too, or I could keep them together and sell them both to Tom. That's what I thought the language said. Is that not what it says?
Yes, that's what it says, but if you add this section here about contiguous lots, and it's just the way it ends up getting written, it tends to say that you can't even convey it if the two lots don't meet subsurface disposal requirements. I mean, under the contiguous lots number 3, you're only concerned about conveying things separately.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Is that understood?
Will you read that paragraph as it's proposed?
Okay, starting at the top of page 25, number 3, contiguous lots, vacant or partially built. If two or more contiguous lots or parcels are in single or joint ownership of record at the time of amendment of the zone, if any of these lots do not individually meet the dimensional requirements of the zone or subsequent amendments, and if one or more of the lots are vacant or contain no principal structure, the non-conforming lots may be conveyed separately as long as the state minimum lot size law, the state wastewater rules, and the town sewage ordinance are complied with.
Does that imply that they're not non-conforming lots to start with?
No, because it says the non-conforming lots may be conveyed.
No, but I mean, it's double jeopardy. You can convey them separately if they meet all of the requirements. If I have an individual lot that meets all the requirements, is it a non-conforming lot?
Under this ordinance, it would become non-conforming once it had less than 40,000 square feet, or if it had less than the minimum frontage requirement, it would immediately become non-conforming.
So the state minimum lot size is something less than 40,000 square feet?
I believe right now there's more than just minimum lot size requirements that go with that law, and I'm assuming that's why they're referencing it.
I'm not going to argue with it. It sounds like something to me like there's an opportunity here, but it's essentially what it says is you have to have a conforming lot in order to convey it as an individual lot. If that's the way it works out, that's fine.
I think, Maureen...
Unless the state minimum lot size is 20,000. Which state minimum lot? Are we talking about the subdivision?
We were talking about the subsurface disposal, which is 10,000 square feet.
Because isn't there one in reference in the subdivision law? There's one in the subsystem disposal, and now there's one in shoreland zoning. So there's three possibilities of state minimum lot size, unless I'm mistaken.
There's one that's really considered minimum lot sizes. I thought it was 20,000 square feet for subsurface septic disposal with a minimum frontage. I think that's the one I thought to be the one that they were referencing.
I believe it's 10,000 instead
of
20.
Is it 10? Is it changed?
Because... When we're working on our affordable housing, we put in requirements what our minimum had to be because code enforcement officer felt that law was going to be changed and that the minimum lot size requirement was going to be eliminated for subsurface disposal on a particular lot. So that is the subsurface, the minimum lot size law that I assume they're referring to.
Yep. Title 12, section, I guess, 4807 is the state minimum lot size law.
Should we make a specific reference to that?
I think what I would suggest is, Maureen, as long as you understand the intent of the change that the board requests here, that be rewritten. And I'm not sure that it requires legal counsel review, but at least to make sure that it's as clear. If it needs to reference state law, then it referenced that. But I guess I would ask you to make sure that you're clear on what the intent is of the board to propose.
My understanding is it's the intent of the board to take advantage of the newest changes to the shoreland zoning, which would allow municipalities to not require merging of these types of lots.
I would suggest that you use the language as closely as what we've proposed here.
Very much.
Okay, good. Any other comments?
On page 25 also, under variances, section B, that sentence ends with district should be zoned.
under Section C, the board shall not grant a variance unless it finds that. And under that first section, there's a reference to Section 8. And the original language in the state language is making a reference to a section that is the land use standard section. What I suggest is appropriate in place of Section 8 is the reference Section 19-3-6, subsection 2, comma, land use performance standards, comma, which are the land use performance standards for shoreline zoning.
Consensus there? Any question? 19-3-6. Two, land use performance. Okay, next.
Page 26.
Mm-hmm.
I would suggest that section 19-3-9 be retitled resource protection, since we have added floodplains instead of just wetlands under that category. Maureen has done that elsewhere.
Would that make it consistent, Maureen? Middle of the page, where it's just 19-3-9.
You may want to add wetlands and floodplain protection, because 19-3-9 still, to a vast extent, is just wetlands regulation. There are only a very few places where it references the RP3 zone at all.
Okay. So that would be wetlands and floodplain?
Mm-hmm. And then what I would recommend following that is the next section in our ordinance on page 41 is the purpose section, which is 19-3-9-01. If Maureen, you could find an appropriate place. That talks only about the wetlands being important to protect, and if somewhere we could insert mention of floodplains as areas to be protected also.
Would that require a change in 01? Is that what you're saying?
It would, for instance, if anyone has their ordinance on page 41, it starts, I won't read the whole paragraph, it starts, the wetlands of the town of Cape Elizabeth are fragile natural resources which provide for wildlife habitat and so on. Considerable wetland acreage nationally has been lost or impaired by drainage, dredging, and so on. Therefore, it is the policy of the town of Cape Elizabeth to ensure that wetlands, perhaps we could say, and floodplains are protected from detrimental impacts. Just something that minor to acknowledge that we are regulating floodplains. Because what happens is the next section, which is 19-3-9-02, which is in front of us, lists those three zones, and the third one is the floodplain zone.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Before we go, I know Judy has a lot of comments. I'm getting a little confused. It may be because I don't know the specific reference under Section 8, but I'm particularly sensitive to the issue of variances, because in my experience, it's hardly, if one is born and exists on the face of the earth, it's almost impossible not to be, in 99% of the cases, the perpetrator of the requirement for a variance. And then it becomes the purview of the zoning board to come up with enough discussion to convince themselves that the applicant has met the state requirements, which in many cases is quite arbitrary. I don't quite understand what under C, the board shall not grant a variance unless it finds that the proposed structure or use would meet the provisions of Section 8, except for the specific provisions which has created the nonconformity and from which relief is sought. Could you give me an example of what that is, what that's saying?
When this ordinance is adopted, there are going to be many existing land uses which no longer are going to comply with anything. And the only way for them to, unless those particular uses are recommended, are recognized in here as non-conforming lots, non-conforming uses, non-conforming structures, and that's why these sections are in here now, because currently, as a shoreline zoning ordinance is administered, there are many variances granted on a regular basis. and when the Department of Environmental Protection took over administration of the shoreline zoning ordinance, they decided that it was not being properly administered, that things that they had never intended to be allowed in the shoreline zone were getting routine variances. The intent of the variance section is that it would be extremely difficult to get approval for anything that is not either recognized as non-conforming or does not comply with existing ordinance. So the idea is that you're not supposed to have a chance to get a variance. That's backed up by the fact that once this ordinance is passed, any application for variance in the shoreline zone will now have to be sent to the Department of Environmental Protection 20 days prior to any hearing by a local board of zoning appeals, and that they will be allowed to comment on that variance, and their comments are supposed to be taken into consideration. So the intent of the whole variance section is to not allow anything to deviate from this ordinance. Frankly, I can't think of a particular example where you would be able to get a variance. I'm sure there are examples, but none come to mind.
If the board would doesn't mind, I'd just like to play out an example so I have a clear understanding of what this is saying. If, for example, one built a cottage within 50 feet of the shore when it was all right to build a cottage 75 feet from the shore when it was all right to do so, and now we're restricting any structures to 100 feet from the high water line. If I only had one location on my lot to build a deck, that clearly would not meet the new setback requirement. Does this say that I can go in and get a variance because of the unique situations that this ordinance has taken my lot into nonconformance?
You would not have to get a variance unless you wanted to build the deck so that it extended closer to the water than your existing building, in which case you would probably not be able to get that at variance. If you wanted to build a deck that, say, extended from the side of the building so that the deck would be no closer to the water's edge than the existing building, that you would be allowed to do, but there are some size limitations. You would also be able to expand the structure if you wanted to put a foundation underneath it, if you wanted to raise the roof up to 30%, but that comes under the whole non-conforming structure provisions.
Would I be able to convey a lot, an individual lot that doesn't meet the three state requirements, and that I could determine or I could demonstrate that I can't get a reasonable return?
Are you talking about a lot that would not have sufficient frontage, and it would not have sufficient lot size?
It would not have sufficient lot size for either subsurface wastewater disposal and the other things that are referenced in the above paragraphs.
And it would not be able to have public sewer?
Correct.
I don't think that lot would be buildable.
What you're saying is changing from simply that it's transferable but not buildable creates
correct
a loss in return. Any further questions or comments on that section? Tom, you look like you're still studying that. Any other questions?
No. Unfortunately, I have, as I drive by, a lot of water bodies in the state of Maine. I think more of other communities and the effects of these state mandates than I do actual applications, although I will admit that I happen to enjoy a zoning board meeting several weeks ago where something very similar to this came up, and the zoning board did grant a variance. Mm-hmm. And I won't say anything more than that, but it was quite extraordinary. quite an extraordinary proceeding to observe, I'll put it that way.
Okay. I would urge that we're going about 45 minutes over. We've got some very patient applicants waiting. This is a tough document to get through, and I ask your patience. I ask, and these changes and corrections or suggestions are important to make this a good document. But if we can be as poignant and swift at this, I would appreciate it. Any other?
I'll continue.
Okay.
They're more brief now. Page 26 still,
mm-hmm.
Final paragraph. That section should be 19-2-8-02.
Final paragraph on 26?
Page 26.
Okay.
A, review.
Dash mm-hmm. 02. No, I left out the zero. Oh.
Page 27. Section 19-3-9-05, additional standards. Since we have now allowed new roads to be built in the floodplains, it should read now, Planning Board may permit construction public utilities, reconstruction of existing roads and resource protection one, blah, blah, blah. And the construction of public utilities and new or existing roads within resource protection 2-wetland protection zones, comma, and resource protection 3-floodplain. And then the rest is written.
Is that by consensus?
Mm-hmm.
Page 28, I'd recommend that the final sentence under subsection B, timber harvesting for other resource protection 1-critical wetland zones, instead of just critical wetlands.
Okay.
Page 29, make note again of Maureen's recommendation mm-hmm. that the code enforcement officer section be moved up. And then in section 1, which starts within 75 feet, recommend that the 4th line read in the middle, provided that there shall be no clear-cut openings and that a well-distributed stand of trees and other vegetation be maintained. Just reads better that way.
Mm-hmm.
On page 30, section 7, we have already addressed as rewording that and moving the code enforcement section, which is two-thirds mm-hmm. down, up below C. On page 31, section 19-3-9-08, agriculture, I'd make the following recommendation under 1. To change the wording to read, there shall be no new agricultural activities in a resource protection 1 critical wetland zone, nor within 75 feet horizontal distance of the wetland upland edge. I think it reads better, and that certainly falls within the buffer area.
So afterwards, zone on the wetland zone, nor?
Delete and buffer area. Simply write nor.
Nor within 15 feet.
75 feet.
I'm sorry. Okay. Agreement there? Okay.
Page 32.
I have notations at the bottom of that page. Okay, that we changed we discussed that, and that will be changed. The plan should be filed with a code enforcement officer.
It would stay code enforcement officer.
Okay.
On page 32, section F. There's a section, I think, just omitted. If you start on the 4th, I'll read the whole thing so it makes sense. Upon determination by the Planning Board that specific areas have not been properly classified and designated on the Cape Elizabeth zoning map as RP1, critical wetland zones, RP2, wetland protection zones, or wetland buffer areas, then such areas shall be, insert, properly classified, and the Cape Elizabeth zoning map shall be periodically updated by the town council to reflect such corrections. That language already exists in the ordinance.
Properly shall be properly
classified, and the Cape Elizabeth zoning map shall be, and it continues, periodically updated.
Okay.
Believe it or not, that's the end of my comments.
Consensus on that last one? Include Okay. Any other?
I just have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Back to page 29, selective cutting of 40% of the total volume of trees. What does volume of trees mean?
It refers to basal area. Are you referencing a particular section?
Section B, 2B, selective cutting of 40% of the total volume of trees.
I would assume that what you would do is pick out all the trees that measure four inches or more in diameter, 4.5 feet off the ground, all of those trees at that particular time, and then you can cut 40% of them over a 10-year period.
Because I take your question to be, are we trying to say number of trees?
Yeah, number of trees, or is it deal with the cross-sectional area of the trees all accumulated? So it accounts
first time I read that, I smiled to myself.
4.5 versus 3-foot diameter trees.
So the question is, you're saying take the count of the total number of trees. Does the word volume come from other
I believe verbiage? Volume refers to size as well as number mm-hmm. of trees.
Okay.
Yeah. Is that defined anywhere, or is that?
There has been some of the new revisions. Also revised timber harvesting, and they did talk about basal area, which is the equivalent of volume, and what I can do is make sure that that's clearly identified. But under the shoreland zoning standards, we're in the wetland protection standards right now, a lot of these standards are, they say the same thing. And in the newer shoreland zoning standards, the reference to basal area has been identified. I can refer to basal area in this section as well to clarify what volume means.
Thank you.
Would the board like that?
Mm-hmm. I think whatever term best describes. Any other questions, comments, corrections? Seeing none, do I hear a motion? Don't be shy. And I would remind whoever makes the motion that the official zoning map is not ready, and should it be taken from the motion?
It should be.
Okay.
What I can do is provide that for the board at a following meeting.
Okay. Judith.
Be it ordered that the Planning Board recommends the attached shoreland zoning amendments to the Town Council for consideration. Or do you want a package? Zoning amendments. Is it?
Okay. Does that include our amendments by consensus? Do we need to put the word by consensus in? Or?
It might be good to add the word as amended.
Okay.
Let's attach the words.
As amended. Okay. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read and second, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, unanimous vote, 4-0. Thank you. And finally, we come to our first order of new business, the last order tonight. We appreciate your patience. I take it you're the applicants for signed permit request by Dr. Stephen Andreasen for a wall signed permit located at 1232A Shore Road, section 21-2-3. Ask that the applicant come to the podium and identify yourself and give us a very short, brief introduction to your application.
Hi, I'm Stephen Andreasen. I'm a new dentist in town, and my proposal is for me and my partner, Peter Kerrigan, for a plywood sign to be placed at 1232A Shore Road. It's the building with the toy store, for those of you who don't know it. It was a general dental practice before, and we'll be doing the same thing there.
Any questions from the board? Seems to be very straightforward.
Thomas, is there any need to indicate the height of the letters? The general dimensions, I don't have any problem with it. I'm just asking from a...
From an ordinance point of view, I don't think so.
I don't believe there's anything in the sign ordinance that regulates height of letters on a sign. It regulates size of sign and height that the sign may be placed on a building.
In fact, the letters can be the entire sign.
Yes.
That's fine.
Tom always likes to ask at least one question.
Okay.
I'm just curious.
Any other questions? Comments? Seeing none, do I hear a motion? Go ahead, Judith.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Dr. Stephen Andreasen for a wall sign located at 1232A Shore Road is granted pursuant to section 21-2-3A of the sign ordinance.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's unanimous vote 4-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sorry to keep you in extra 50 minutes.
He's not in the shoreline zone by any chance, is he?
What's that?
He's not in the shoreline zone.
Oh. Is there any other business to take up this evening? Seeing none, do I hear a motion to adjourn? Please. Moved, seconded. In favor? Unanimous? Thank you very much.